Good morning. I was given a request from our suggestion box that Rick mentioned. There was a request for a sermon topic, and I'm going to try my best to cover that. I think that the topic was specifically God as my portion. I kind of changed the title to God is my portion. There's a statement made in Lamentations 3:24 to that effect. I think hopefully this gets at the point of the one interested in this idea. So we're going to break the bread of life this morning, predominantly in the Old Testament, as Lamentations certainly is in the Old Testament. But I want to thank those who do give me topics to study from. Takes me a little out of my comfort zone. That's a good thing. And hopefully it's going to be helpful for you as we study through this together. And this is something I don't usually think about. If I really think about it, I don't really use the word portion that often. I know what the word portion means. You know, if you have a pie and we're going to share it, you know, maybe this is my portion and that's your portion. I don't use that word very often. This is my share. This is my piece or something I might say. But this phrase as God as my portion, that's just really something I hadn't thought of. And so I guess this morning I'd like to take you through my study in this. Maybe we can discover these things together. Obviously, I prepared this, but I kind of want to take you through the journey I went on to understand this better. Because perhaps you're like me in this this idea of God as my portion is not something top of mind for you. So I want to find the significance of what this means in the Word of God. So firstly, this idea of this, the meaning of that word portion, you know, is it about pie? I mean, it's not about pie, but the concept isn't that far off. You know, we can look at this. This is a report from the King James Version, and the Hebrew word that underlies this idea that's usually translated portion, I think it's pronounced chelek or something like that. This word is used 66 times in the Old Testament, and usually in this big blue portion on the chart, normally it's translated something like portion, which is that word we started with. But sometimes it's part, or you know, the idea of an inheritance. Some other less frequently used words there, but these are maybe getting to the idea of this portion, or this part, of this inheritance. If we go to the translation I usually use, the Legacy Standard Bible, it uses some different words, but a lot of the same ideas. The portion, or a share, relationship to property, or the division of things, an inheritance, and the reward, or even in one reference to farmland. So I wanted to kind of drill down into that and survey, you know, this is just a summary report of all the ways it's used, but digging into some of those 66 places where it is in fact used. I'm not going to go through 66 verses here this morning, but just to give a representative sampling of some things we can discover as we look into that. And one of the things that bubbles to the top is this idea of a physical inheritance as your portion. And an example in Genesis chapter 31, verse 14, and that's a situation where Rachel and Leah and their father Laban was sort of ripping off their husband Jacob with regard to his work and essentially their inheritance. And it says there in Genesis 31:14, then Rachel and Leah said to him, "Do we still have any portion or inheritance in our father's house?" You know, given that he's kind of ripping off our husband and we're leaving and all this. And it seems to be the idea that their dad was just in it for the money, and there's nothing for their husband, or ultimately for them as daughters and their family. So it seems to be related to their physical possessions and their land and the idea of their inheritance. So that physical idea. Now, to jump to a different passage, Numbers chapter 18 in the book of Numbers. Of course, in the law, the different tribes are given different physical plots of land for where their tribes are going to reside. But there's something special, something different that happens with the Levites, the tribe of the priests, and Aaron. So in Numbers chapter 18, verse 20, it says, then Yahweh, the name of the Lord, Then Yahweh said to Aaron, you shall have no inheritance in their land, nor any portion among them. I am your portion and your inheritance among the sons of Israel. So we're starting to get to this idea of God. He says I there about himself. God is the portion for Aaron, for their inheritance or their portion. So they weren't given physical land, but instead of trusting in that land to do the farming and, you know, that's how they're going to make their money, they're instead supposed to trust in God to be their portion. And God's provisions instead of physically doing those things. And so the next verse kind of gets into the idea of how that would work. That's a practical matter of the tithes that are given to take care of their physical needs. In verse 21, now to the sons of Levi, behold, I have given all the tithe in Israel for an inheritance in return from their service for which they perform in the service of the tent of meeting. So the tithe, of course, is where the people of Israel would come and worship at the temple, and they would give certain gifts of their income and that sort of thing. And that would go to help the Levites to have an income, because they don't have land. They don't have a source of income other than that, than to serve the Lord as priests. So for this idea of God being the portion of the Levites, it's that they'd be trusting in God's plan for them instead of making other plans for themselves or to thinking about the traditional way to just, you know, earn a living the way we would normally think of. So thinking about those contexts we just looked at, you know, the physical inheritance, like the daughters of Laban, or this idea of contrasting trusting in God versus doing things for ourselves, for the Levites. There's other passages that talk about God's portion. So here we've talked about God is my portion, or God is the portion of the Levites. But what about the idea of God's portion? And I found a passage along those lines in Deuteronomy 32, verses 8 and 9. It says, when the Most High gave the nations their inheritance, when he separated the sons of man, he set the boundaries of the peoples according to the number of the sons of Israel, or your translation might say sons of God or something like that, because the Dead Sea Scrolls, there's a difference there. But anyway, verse 9, for Yahweh's portion is his people, Jacob, or Israel, right? Jacob or Israel is the allotment of his inheritance. So if we think back to how God separated the nations at the incident with the Tower of Babel and confused their languages and all of that, all the different nations had all different situations going on, but the God of Israel had as his special people, the people of Israel, people of Jacob, as his allotments, his allotment or his inheritance, we might say. And of course, that's accommodative language. God owns everything. The cattle on a thousand hills belong to the Lord. Everything belongs to the Lord. He's the creator of all the earth. But he had a special relationship with Jacob and Israel. They were his special people. And his plan to bring the Messiah comes through that special people. And of course, ultimately, all nations are blessed. Going back to the promise made prior to all this to Abraham, where all nations will be blessed through his seed, which then goes through Jacob and Israel and all that. And so ultimately, we're beneficiaries of that. And how much better that we are God's portion now, that he includes all of us, kind of going back to some things we've studied recently in the letter to the Romans. But going back to what we're talking about here, what are passages that talk about how God is my portion? Kind of the question that we were given here originally. God is my portion. Well, there's a number of passages that say that. Psalm 16, verse 5. Yahweh is the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You support my lot. And these words often go together. The portion and the inheritance and the lot. These concepts all seem to flow together. In this context, it's in contrast to the other gods, the idols, the false gods. Instead of all that garbage, false god stuff, Yahweh, the true God of Israel, is the portion of my inheritance and my cup. You support my lot. You take care of me. I trust in him, not all those other false gods that are worthless. That's the idea here in Psalm 16. Now, if we jump to Psalm 73, we see another occurrence of this here. Psalm 73, starting in verse 25. Whom have I in heaven but you? And besides you, I desire nothing on earth. My flesh and my heart fail, but God is the rock of my heart and my portion forever. For behold, those who are far from you will perish. You have destroyed everyone who is unfaithful to you. But as for me, the nearness of God is my good. I have set Lord Yahweh as my refuge, that I may recount all your works. So the idea is that we have no one in heaven other than the true God of Israel. He is most high. He's the one and only. As it says, God is one. Hear, O Israel, the God is one. He's our rock. And he's our portion, that word that we're kind of zeroing in on here. And we need him. And without him, we'll perish. If we're unfaithful, we'll be judged. So we should be faithful. He is our refuge, our hiding place. And we're to praise him for his works, as it says, that I may recount all your works, praising him by saying all of the great things that he has done. So this idea of the portion is that that's where it's at. He has what we need, and we trust in him. Psalm 119 makes a reference to this idea in verse 57. Yahweh is my portion. I have promised to keep your words. So this idea that we're having a level of devotion to him. We're keeping his words. We're following his will. We're being faithful to honor and respect God. So a lot of this study, looking at these different things, really led me to some passages relating to Jeremiah. Some of the most striking examples seem to be related to things that he says, and in the book of Lamentations as well. So if we think about Jeremiah, the background of what the deal was with him, you know, maybe taking a step back even from Jeremiah, just God's interactions with the people of Israel, God always promised as a threat in a way, a part of his covenant involved blessings and curses. So if people didn't follow his covenant, there would be punishment and exile. So we can look at a passage like Leviticus 18, where some of this comes out when the law was first instituted. But as for you, you shall keep my statutes and my judgments, and shall not do any of these abominations, referring to all the wicked idol worshiping that the people of the land had done, and they had come in there to take that land because of that wickedness. So don't do any of that stuff. They were dying. Neither the native nor the sojourner who sojourns among you. For all the men of the land who have been before you have done all these abominations, and the Lord and the land has become defiled, so that the land will not vomit you out. Should you defile it as it has vomited out the nations that has been before you. So don't just do the same evil, wicked things they did, or you're going to be cast out too. And of course, big picture, that's what ultimately comes to pass. And this sort of sentiment is repeated numerous places in the Law of Moses. So as we think about that, as time went on, generations go on, people do get involved in idolatry, and idolatry is closely linked with adultery, both in terms of what is involved in idolatry, but also in the way that God looks at it. There's a sense in which God is the husband of the people of Israel, and they are unfaithful to him and break that marriage-like covenant. Of course, we think about that as well, as the church is the bride of Christ, and we need to be faithful to him as well. But the people get wrapped up in all of these wicked things, and Jeremiah goes as a prophet. He was already a priest, but then he is commissioned additionally as a prophet to go and warn Judah, those southern kingdom there, but they ignored him. And it went on and on to the point where they're past judgment. Judgment is coming. Don't even pray for them anymore, because judgment's just coming. And so judgment comes, the destruction of the land, the city, and the temple, and into exile, into captivity. And then that all leads to the context of the book of Lamentations. technically, the Book of Lamentations is anonymous if you read through what it actually says, but it's thought to be written by Jeremiah. And if you flip to the Book of Lamentations, it's right after Isaiah is really big. So Isaiah, Jeremiah, Lamentations, you'll find it. It's kind of a short book, but that's a good way to find it. So it's Lamentations is made up of five chapters. You might say five poems. They're kind of like the unique little poems that stand alone in a way, but obviously they're all collected in this book together. And in Lamentations, there's an alphabetical acrostic, and your Bible may or may not indicate that. My Bible does. I have the alphabetical letter on top of each verse, sort of like Psalm 119. Most Bibles do show it there, to indicate that this sort of runs through the Hebrew alphabet for the words that begin each verse, is what that's indicating. And so there's 22 letters in the Hebrew alphabet, so you'll notice there's 22 verses in chapter 1 and chapter 2, and then chapter 3, there's 66 verses. Because in chapter 3, they do the letter, and then the next letter three times. So it's times 22 times 3. And then chapter 4 is back to the 22. And then chapter 5, there's 22 verses, but it's not alphabetical anymore. It's just more chaotic. And it may be part of the message, as what Lamentations is about, as the name suggests. It's all this wailing and mourning and horrible, upset recounting of the things that went on with the judgment. Now we'll come back to chapter 3. There's some special things in chapter 3 that we'll think about that are a little bit different than the rest of the letter or the book. But it's really just a series of laments. They're very sad. They're kind of like funeral dirges. There's wailing, crying out to God for mercy, saying things like, you know, we have sinned, we are suffering, and detailing that suffering. You know, will you remember us, God? Will you restore us? Will you remember your promises? And let's get back to that. Yes, we've sinned and you have punished us, but you have promises that continue, and remember us, and let's get back to that. That seems to be a summary of the ideas in Lamentations. And if you break that down a little more, chapter 1 is the poem where Jerusalem, which was destroyed, Jerusalem is sort of personified as a woman. And she's called the daughter of Zion. And she's just mourning and talking about all the horrible things that happened. And chapter 2 recounts the horrors of the destruction of Jerusalem, and it acknowledges the wrath of God for our sins. It goes even to some details like mothers eating their children in the course of all this. Just horrible, disgusting things. It's just a horrible book. I don't want to say that. It's a horrible book. It's the Word of God, but it's just so depressing and sad. It just covers these things that can only be described as horrible, these judgments and these awful things that go on and how people suffer. And in the context of Lamentations, suffering for as judgment for their sin. Chapter 3 looks at these things a little bit more individualized, and perhaps if we think Jeremiah wrote it, maybe it's the idea of Jeremiah writing about himself and his mourning and how he's calling out to God and describing his suffering. Chapter 4 has these comparisons of, you know, before the judgment, how it was, and you know, we had things great, and we were well off, and you know, it was a beautiful day, and the children were playing, and all these pleasant things, as contrasted with the dust and the destruction and just the horrible things that have come with the judgment. We had prosperity and blessings that we enjoyed with God, but now there's this horror and the suffering as a result of our sin and the judgment that we brought upon ourselves as a result of our sin. And then chapter 5 is just this, the people are crying out for God to remember them and crying for mercy. You know, will you remember us? And there's really no resolution in the book. It's not like and happily ever after in chapter 6. There's no chapter 6. But of course, the Bible doesn't end there. We understand that God does bring them back from captivity. And then ultimately, in Christ, we have a lot of these blessings brought forward, the forgiveness that we have in Christ. But I want to look a little bit closer at chapter 3 in Lamentations to get to our idea that we're skirting around, this idea of God is our portion. So Lamentations 3, 16 through 26 covers this idea of suffering. We get a little bit of the flavor of the book. I've tried to describe it to you. We're going to read all five chapters this morning, but you get the idea of this suffering, but then the special things that come out in this brief passage aren't just the suffering, but the hope and about God's compassion and about God's faithfulness, and then this idea how God is my portion. So we'll see a little bit of the suffering side and the hopeful side. So Lamentations 3, 16 through 26. He has broken my teeth with gravel. He has made me cower in the dust. My soul has been rejected from peace. I have forgotten goodness. So I say, my strength has perished, as well as my hopeful waiting, which comes from Yahweh. Remember my affliction and my homelessness, the wormwood and gall, the idea of bitterness. Surely my soul remembers and is bowed down within me. And then in verse 21 here, this I will return to my heart. Therefore, I will wait in hope. The loving kindness of Yahweh, indeed, the loving kindnesses of Yahweh indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. And we have a song that uses this as a basis. We'll sing shortly. I didn't tell you that part. We'll sing a song. These compassions are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Yahweh is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will wait for him. Yahweh is good to those who hope in him, to the soul who seeks him. It is good that he waits silently for the salvation of Yahweh. This I will return to my heart. Therefore, I will wait in hope. Verse 22. The loving kindnesses of Yahweh indeed never cease, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. So there's all this suffering and judgment that's mentioned in there, but there's also that silver lining that's in the ruins of all of that. Verse 21, back here, verse 21, this I will return to my heart. Therefore, I will wait in hope. We turn our hearts to God in hope. We have trust in his promises. Of course, that hope is that confident expectation that we know he has promises, and his promises are true. Verse 22, the loving kindnesses, plural, and the compassions of God never cease. They never fail. His faithful, loyal love that he has for us. He has compassion. He's slow to anger. Of course, in the context, look at all this judgment he's just brought, but he's been slow to anger. But the people of God took a long time in sin and sin and sin and ignoring and just going on and on with this to make God angry and for him to ultimately bring his judgment. But he's full of compassion. He wants people to return. In verse 23, they are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. There are fresh blessings to come every morning. And we can think about a passage even from the New Testament where Paul writes in 2 Corinthians chapter 4, where we have this idea of renewal. 2 Corinthians 4, 16 through 18. Therefore, we do not lose heart, but though our outer man is decaying, but our inner man is being renewed day by day. For our momentary light affliction, this idea of suffering, is working out for us an eternal weight of glory, far beyond all comparison. While we look not at the things which are seen, the physical things that we see around about us, but at the things which are not seen, the things that we understand to be true by faith. For the things which are seen are temporal, temporary, but the things which are not seen are eternal. So big picture, God helps us. The sufferings that we may endure are for a short time, but his eternal reward is that. It is eternal. It is forever. But back to Lamentations, chapter 3, verse 24, where it says, Yahweh is my portion, says my soul. Therefore, I will wait for him. So in the midst of all of this suffering, all of this loss, you know, this person, perhaps Jeremiah talking about his loss. You know, I've lost my nation. I've lost family members. They've been killed by the Babylonians who've come in and brought judgment. I've lost my health. I've lost my wealth. I've lost my freedom and my land. All the things that we might value reasonably. We might say in that situation, you know, I've lost it all. All is lost. I don't have anything. But no, that's not the idea we should have here. What is the most valuable inheritance or portion that we should understand? It's the idea of God and his promises, the eternal life that we have in him, the hope of eternal life. And we wait for his time. You know, this person's struggling and suffering, or maybe you're struggling and suffering, and, you know, when will this be over? Well, God has his own time. And 2 Peter talks about that in 2 Peter 3, 8 and 9, where he says, but do not let this one fact escape your notice, beloved, that with the Lord, one day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years like one day. But the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some consider slowness. You know, it might seem slow if it's 1,000 years. It seems slow to me. But that's not the way we should think about it. He's patient toward you, not willing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. So this idea of that judgment day that's coming is being delayed. And we might think, oh, well, God's not really coming back. Christ isn't going to return. Everything's fine. Well, he's coming, but he wants us to have time to repent. God's timetable is what God wants it to be. And our place is to say, I will wait for him. If we look at Jeremiah 29, where he's addressing the exiles who are, you know, at this point in judgment, in exile, there's this message of hope that perhaps we sometimes take out of context. Jeremiah 29, verse 10, where it says here, for thus says Yahweh, when 70 years have been fulfilled for Babylon. So, okay, you're in, perhaps newly in captivity. And what's going to happen? Well, let me tell you. When 70 years have been fulfilled for Babylon, I will visit you and establish my good word to you, to return you to this place. I won't forget. It's my timetable. And my timetable, in this case, is 70 years. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares Yahweh. Plans for peace and not for calamity. To give you a future and a hope. And that's the part where that's a good greeting card. You know, we maybe take that out of context. We like that idea that God has plans for peace for us and not for calamity, to give us a future and hope. And those are all true things. But notice the context here. You're in captivity and you don't like it. And you're going to be there for 70 years. God has a plan and it's in his time, and things are going to change and his will is going to be done and things will be better. But probably for your children, right? If you're there in captivity as an adult, you're looking at 70 more years. That's not for you. That's for the future of their family. Verse 12, then you will call upon me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And that's the way we should be seeking him and searching for him so we can find him with all of our heart. Back here to Lamentations, verse 25, Yahweh is good. He's good to those who hope in him, to the soul who seeks him. Just as we had read here that we are to wait for him. As Peter said, you know, we're waiting on God's timetable. And Jeremiah 29, we're to wait 70 years. Those folks were to wait 70 years. God has good plans for you, but it's 70 years. And here, we're told to hope and to expect him to fulfill his promises, to seek him out actively. And verse 26, it is good that he waits silently for the salvation of Yahweh. There's lots of waiting on God, and we don't really like that in our culture, do we? When we order something from Amazon, and if it takes 4 days, we're all upset. It's got to be here tomorrow or in 2 days. But we need to not have that attitude with God. We need to wait on God. We need to recognize his timetable is not our timetable. He is faithful. And with thinking about how God is so faithful, let's grab our hymnals, change gears for a moment, and turn to number 23 in Hymns for Worship. Great is thy faithfulness. And that's taken from this passage. And I just couldn't help but be excited and share the song together with you. Let's sing, Great is thy faithfulness. God is faithful. And let's praise him for that.
Great is thy faithfulness, O God, my Father. There is no shadow of turning with thee. Thou changest not, thy compassions, they fail not. As thou hast been, thou forever wilt be. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Summer and winter and springtime and harvest, sun, moon, and stars in their courses above, join with all nature in manifold witness to thy great faithfulness, mercy, and love. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Pardon for sin, and a peace that endureth, thine own dear presence to cheer and to guide, strength for today, hope for tomorrow, blessings all mine with 10,000 beside. Great is thy faithfulness, great is thy faithfulness. Morning by morning, new mercies I see. All I have needed, thy hand hath provided. Great is thy faithfulness, Lord, unto me. Amen.
And God is faithful. A lot of times we think about, well, we need to be faithful, and we do. But we need God to be faithful too. And again, that idea of a marriage that goes both ways. And God is absolutely faithful. But what about us? How does this all relate to us? Now, thinking more about Jeremiah, we can go to Jeremiah chapter 31. That may be too small to read, but you can go to your Bible. Jeremiah 31, looking at verse 31 and onward, talking about this idea of a new covenant. There's this hope in Jeremiah in the midst of all of this judgment that there's this new covenant coming. Verse 31, behold, days are coming, declares Yahweh, when I will cut a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah, not like the covenant which I cut with their fathers in the day I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. My covenant which they broke, which is why they're in judgment now. But I was a husband to them, declares Yahweh. He was faithful. But this is the covenant which I will cut with the house of Israel after those days, declares Yahweh. I will put my law within them on their heart, and I will write it. And I will be their God, and they shall be my people. And they will not teach again each man his neighbor, and each man his brother, saying, Know Yahweh, for they will all know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, declares Yahweh. For I will forgive their iniquity, and their sin I will remember no more. Now this is talking about the situation we have today with Christ and the church. You know, you think about the Old Testament law where people were, you know, physically born into the land of Israel and the people of Israel. And they had to be taught to actually follow God. And so often they were, you know, involved in idol worship or whatever, and they had to be brought back in this or that. Whereas the people of God today were people of God because we are in Christ. We're not just born physically into some family and then we have to be taught all this. We're taught and learn those things, and then as we come to faith and we obey the gospel in Christ, we know that. We don't need someone to tell us to know the Lord because we know him. That's why we are in Christ. And he says, I will forgive their iniquity and their sin I'll remember no more. And we understand in Christ, that's where we have forgiveness of sins. That's where we have more hope than they had. We have more blessings. So as we think about God being our portion, what a great blessing we have in Christ. So what about our portion? What is our portion? Hebrews chapter 9, verse 15. And for this reason, he is the mediator, referring to Christ, the better mediator. He is the mediator of a new covenant. So that since a death has taken place for the redemption of the trespasses that were committed under the first covenant, those who have been called may receive the promise of the eternal inheritance. That idea of inheritance, the portion, the lot, it's an eternal inheritance that we have in Christ. Eternal life to be forever with the Lord, be forever with God. So we should say, God is my portion, having some increased understanding of what that means. And he's our inheritance. You know, we can think about that idea of a physical inheritance that we talked about, inheriting land or possessions or whatever, but we should be thinking more about the spiritual blessings that we have. Based on the context, the word's gonna mean different things. But in our context, God is our inheritance in Christ. All of our hope is in him. To the extent we have sufferings, either due to judgment for our sin, or just due to health or circumstances, relationships, war, We see things going on over in Israel today with war. Things come on surprisingly. These sufferings come, but they're temporary. God's promises are true. God's timetable is not our own. We need to wait for Him. We need to have patience and give things time and endure during that time, trusting in God, hoping in His promises, seeking for Him, searching Him out, searching through our Bibles, and learning more about Him, conforming our lives, transforming our lives more to be conformed to the image of His Son. So that's the message for you. Perhaps I've scratched the surface on the idea of how Yahweh is our portion, but perhaps this helps you to do a further study on your own and think about these things. Passage to leave you with is verse 24, Yahweh is my portion. They're from Lamentations. Yahweh is my portion, says my soul within myself, you know. Therefore, I wait for Him. Is He your portion? Is He your inheritance? Are you children of God? Well, then you have this inheritance. But if you're not a child of God, then you aren't part of this inheritance. You know, some of the people who heard what Jesus had to say when He was on the earth teaching His teachings, you know, and in John chapter 6, verse 67, after He had some hard sayings, and some people left, they just left. That was their hard sayings, we're leaving Him. And so in verse 67, so Jesus said to the 12, you know, his 12 disciples that were there with Him, do you also want to go? And Simon Peter, who often is the one who answered, Simon Peter answered to Him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Jesus has the words of eternal life. You know, he gives us the great commission that we should go and make disciples and baptize them and teach them all the things. You know, are we doing all of that? Have you done that? Can we help you in any way? I've got us in the wrong number in our songbook now that I've introduced one here, but we're going to sing number 194, When We All Get to Heaven. Well, does all include you? Are you a child of God? We want it to include you. When we all get to heaven, will you be there? Do you need to respond to the gospel? I encourage you to come as we stand and sing the song.